presentation of the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Buckingham Police calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 69. A holdup. Suspected driver is 5 feet 10 or 11 inches. Weighed about 190 pounds. Escaped in a maroon colored coupe. License number unknown. This suspect held up and robbed May West. Motion picture actress. A more than $15,000. Jewelry and cash. Go get him, boy. That's all. Rolls and clips.
Many listeners tonight have already read the story of the May West diamond robbery in the March issue of Calling All Cars News. Over 300,000 motorists have already driven into Rio Grande service stations and asked for their free copy of this unique publication. But this isn't the only free gift you get from Rio Grande. If you fill up with Rio Grande cracked gasoline, you get extra speed, extra power, extra energy for emergencies, extra fast starting. And all these extras are free because you pay no more for Rio Grande cracked gasoline with tetraethyl than for uncracked gasoline which lacks these extra features. Because of these extra features at no extra cost, the police department which solved the May West robbery has specified Rio Grande cracked gasoline for all police cars for 3 consecutive years. You get another free gift if you ask your Rio Grande service station for Sinclair Opaline Motor Oil. It comes in oversized cans, a quart for a quarter, with 2 extra ounces free. You save when you buy Sinclair Opaline, yet you get complete motor protection. Sinclair Opaline Motor Oil enjoys a worldwide sale and is world famous for quality. The price is lower because the sales are larger. You see, the independent service stations selling Rio Grande cracked gasoline and Sinclair Opaline Motor Oil are actually giving you better values for your money. During 1935, it will be the policy of Calling All Cars to bring you from time to time rebroadcasts of outstanding cases we have dramatized in the past. Thousands of you have written us and expressed your desire to hear the May West jewel robbery dramatized again. So it is with pleasure that Calling All Cars tonight brings you the May West jewel robbery with Miss Martha Wentworth playing her now famous impersonation of Miss West. What other past cases of Calling All Cars would you like to hear again? Write to Calling All Cars, care of the station to which you are now listening, and tell us what preceding case you would like to hear. And now we turn the microphone over to Chief James G. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department, who has a message for you.
Good evening, friends. When I became chief of police, there were several crimes on the police records which had not, I felt, been investigated to the utmost. To run down these crimes, I selected from the force 3 officers, Detective Lieutenant S.S. Stone, W.M. Robinson, and E.Y. Kinett, and appointed them special investigators working directly under my supervision. Among these unsolved cases was the theft of the May West jewels. I assigned Robinson and Stone to work on this case, which was, at that time, more than a year old. Although every peace officer in Los Angeles County had worked diligently on this case, nothing had been discovered of any value. Still, I felt that the case could be solved. The quickness and dispatch with which Lieutenants Robinson and Stone brought the case to a successful close speaks more volumes than any words I could utter in praise of them. Tonight's dramatization is based completely on the confidential reports of the investigating officers and the court transcript of the trial of David Friedman. It has also been read and approved by the plaintiff, Miss May West. I turn now to Frederick Lindsley, who will tell you of the May West jewel robbery.
In the latter part of September 1932, May West's automobile is damaged in an accident. She is seriously inconvenienced by the lack of a car. And we find her in her apartment on North Throckmorton, talking the situation over with her manager, James Timoney.
Well, pull it, Jim. It's a nuisance dealing without a car right now with its new picture stopping.
Yeah, you can rent a car.
Yeah, and put your life in the hands of any palooka they send along to drive it.
Yeah, you could use cabs.
Oh, it's just as bad. And anyway, there's never a cab around the studio when you want one. See who it is, will you, Jim?
Sure. Hello. It's West's department. Who? Let's come in and I'll see. There's a Mr. Bennett in the lobby. You in?
Oh, that's Dave. Sure. Tell him to come up.
Send him up, please. Hey, this guy.
Oh, you heard me speak of Dave Brennan? His wife and I were good friends in the big town.
Oh, yeah. Seems to me I do remember the name.
Well, he looked me up at the studio today. Just driven in town. I told him to come up and sing us some song. Well, Revolver, what's the matter with you? Hey, Jim, this monkey looks hungry. Did you feed him?
Yeah, right on his throat at 7.
Oh, okay. What is it, fellow? What are you trying to tell me? Well, Jim, the Revolver here, he has more sense than any man I've ever met. Except in you, of course.
Well, thanks for the exception. If you're all on your manager, and that does require some sense.
Yeah, I guess it does. Well, that must be Dave, Jim. I'll let him in.
Oh, Dave. Good to see you again.
Good to see you, man.
Well, I didn't have a minute to talk to you this afternoon. Come on in. Oh, tell me, how's Marg?
Fine as silk, May. Wants to be remembered to you and everything.
Oh, gee, that's swell. Oh, Dave, this is Jim Timoney, the manager. I don't think you ever met. Jim, this is Dave Brennan.
How you doing? Hello, Jim. I'm glad to know you.
Sit down, Dave. Have a cigarette?
Fine. Gold tip, hmm? Doing all right, ain't you, May? Little different from the time they closed Pleasure Man over in Jersey, eh?
Well, I wasn't doing so bad then either.
Yeah, you ring the bell every time, May. Well, tell me, how's every little thing out here in Hollywood?
Oh, it's okay. I can't complain. Only I'm walking instead of riding these days.
Well, what are you talking about, May? You walking? You turned over in a new leaf?
Oh, don't be funny. Well, that lousy chauffeur of mine wrecked the car the other night, and I fired him. And I'm still fixing the car, so I haven't a chauffeur or even a car to put him in.
Hey, that's tough. And the same, May, I'd be glad to help you out.
What do you mean?
Well, I'm not doing anything out here, just looking the place over. I'll drive you around.
Oh, no, Dave, I couldn't ask you to do that.
Why not? You're welcome to it.
Oh, Jim, that sounds like the answer to a maiden's prayer.
Well, anyway, the answer to a prayer. Okay, then I'm your new chauffeur.
Oh, Dave, I accept with pleasure.
So Dave Brennan's friend serves as Miss West's chauffeur. In a few days, he's completely familiar with her daily schedule. Then on September 27th, 1932, as he's driving Timoney and her along Wilshire Boulevard.
Hey, Dave, stop here a minute, will you?
Where's that, May?
It's shop at the next corner. I got to see about a fitting.
Ah, come on, May. Let her go till later. I got an appointment with that chatter writer at the studio. We have a rehearsal.
Oh, well, Jim, it'll only take a minute.
Yeah, no, your minute. Here's a couple of hours.
Listen, you egg. I'll give you each a dollar for every minute I'm in here, over 10.
That's a bet. Hey, this is the easiest show you ever made.
Yeah, if you make it.
Well, here she comes at last.
Yeah, and look at all the fun.
Yeah, what did I tell you? What's the place out?
There, boys. That wasn't long, was it?
Yeah, not much. Been 26 minutes in there.
26 minutes? Mm. Oh, you're
foolish. Oh, man, that's right. 26 minutes. So you owe us $16.
Oh, it was worth it. I found some of the loveliest lines.
Never mind what you found, May. Come on, pay off.
Well, gee, I can't right now.
Well, why not?
Well, I haven't got the car.
Oh, go on. You're a biker.
Oh, on the level. I haven't any change.
Woman, I don't trust you. Let's see your purse.
Here you are.
$3,000 notes and $400.
nothing smaller, so I can't pay off.
What's the idea of toting that fortune around with you, May?
I just got it out of the bank. I'm spending it here. You know, my mother.
Yeah. It isn't safe to carry it around like that.
I'm getting the postal order for it this afternoon.
No, no, you're not. We've got rehearsals all afternoon and all day tomorrow, too.
Oh, I'll have to carry it with me, then.
$3,000 and $4,000. The next afternoon, Dave Brennan makes a date to meet a friend of his at the corner of 6th and Rampart.
Hello, Dave.
Hello, Ed.
This is a pal of mine. Shake hands with Sammy. He's one of the boys.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. What's on your mind, Dave?
Listen. Do you want to make a grand?
What's the job?
Grab Mae West jewelry and her dough.
Sure, that's worth a grand. How about my pal here?
Oh, I'll cut him in for a grand, too.
Fair enough. How about it, Sammy?
Well, fair enough. Okay, hop in and I'll take you out to the joint and give you the layup. Well, here we are. There's the apartment house where she lives, see?
Yeah, but it's going to be sort of tough making a getaway from that joint.
Wait a minute. You don't have to knock her over in there. Like I've been telling you, I've been driving her around, see? Now, every night after she leaves the studio, her and Jim Timoney, that's her manager, and me, we all put on the feed bag together, see? And right on the dot of 7, we pull up here, and Timoney goes up and feeds Revolver.
What do you mean? He loads his gun?
No. Revolver's the name of a pet monkey.
Oh, I get it.
Now, look here. I drive her up here at 7 sharp. I'll pull up by that fire plug across the street, see? Nobody will be parked by it. There's sure to be a vacant place there.
Yeah, then what?
You guys be parked right here. When you see Timoney get out of the car and go into the apartment house, you move in, see?
Easy.
Get the rocks and the dough and take it on the lamb. I'll meet you at 11 p.m. at the same place as this afternoon. That night, as is her custom, Miss West returns to her apartment house at 7 o'clock and requests Timoney to feed the monkey. She waits in the car, intending to go on to the fight. She has been chatting with Brennan about 3 minutes when she notices a man, coat collar turned up around his face, hat pulled low, swaggered across the street toward the car.
Oh, Dave. I don't like the looks of this guy coming across the street.
Oh. Oh, him. Just some drunk, I guess.
Oh, maybe. But what's that he's got in his hand?
I don't know. Looks like a handkerchief.
It's a sticker. Hand over the poke.
What?
I said hand over the poke. Come on, give it to me. Now, give me the bracelet. Quit stalling.
Oh, don't get in a hurry.
Take your time, buddy. You'll get it.
Oh, there you are.
Now, that necklace. Come on, make it snappy. Good. Now I'll have those rings.
Well, you haven't overlooked anything, have you?
No, I can't think of anything. Can you? Now listen, Mug. Start this car. Keep on going, and don't look back.
Okay, okay.
Oh, Dave, stop.
He said to keep on going.
I don't care what he said. Stop right here. I've got to try to get his number.
All right.
Big mug.
Yeah, he's able to turn the heat on you, May. He sounded tough to me.
Oh, he's nothing but a hoodlum.
Well, did you see anything?
No, I couldn't get the number. It's a coupe, that's all I made out.
Yeah, what's the matter, May? The idea of standing here in the middle of the street. Anything wrong?
Oh, it's plenty wrong. Some mug just turned a rod on me and lifted my jewelry and that dough I was carrying.
Well, come on, let's report you to the police right away.
Hey, listen, May, I wouldn't do that.
Well, why not?
Well, if you get the bulls on this job, you may never see the rocks again. I tell you, these gunmen are tough monkeys.
Oh, what did you propose doing?
Now, listen, you leave this thing to me for a few days, will you?
Why, what could you do about it?
Well, I had some connections back east. Might do some good out here. Let me look up some guys, and maybe I can get the stuff back for you.
Well, what are you afraid, Jim?
If you think you can reclaim the stuff, go to it, Dave.
Later, Dave does reclaim the stuff for himself.
Well, boys, that was one of the neatest jobs I ever saw pulled. Nothing messy, you know. Clean from start to finish.
Thanks, Dave. Here's the stuff.
Let me see. Ah, swell.
Wait a minute.
What about our cut?
No, I'll pay you off in a couple of days.
Yeah, well, why not now? You got $3,000 there.
Say, you don't want to try to change $1,000 bill with every bull in town looking for them the way they made it, do you?
Well, no.
No, I'm trying to stall May from reporting it to the cops, but she might jump out of line. Now, you fellas just leave this all to me, and I'll pay you guys off day after tomorrow.
Okay, Dave.
Say, Dave.
What?
Hadn't you better return the ice?
Why?
Look, Dave, those rocks are her business. She looks like a good dame to me. We got $1,000 apiece of her dough. Ain't that enough?
Yeah, but there might be another $10,000 in sparklers there. Hey, you don't expect me to turn that back, do you?
Look, Dave, it's none of my business. I done the job for you, and you're going to pay me off.
The deal
with the rocks is your own business. But if I was you, I'd turn them back. Gee, the dame's going to make a pitcher soon, and she's going to need him.
Well, maybe you're right.
Sure I am, Dave. Give him back to her.
Okay, pal. I will.
The next morning, Timoney and Miss West are discussing the robbery in her apartment when the phone rings.
Well, answer it, May. Hello.
I want to talk to Miss West.
Who's speaking? This is your manager.
Well, you do. It's about that holdup last night.
Yeah, yeah. Get a load of this, May. Well, what about it?
Well, I just wanted to tell you where you can find the purse.
The phone? Where is it?
Well, you go down Rossmore from the apartment to Rosewood Avenue.
Yeah.
Then you turn to the right.
Yeah.
Well, in the middle of the block is a white garage. And behind the garage is a pile of lumber. And under the lumber, you'll find the purse.
Well, that's fine. Now, where is this Rosewood Avenue? It's in here, Los Angeles, you know.
It ain't far from your apartment. Next block, down Rossmore.
What's that? I'm a little deaf.
I said the next block, down Rossmore from your apartment.
Yeah, I see. And you said something about a garage.
Yeah, I said the purse is behind the white garage in the middle of the block, under a pile of lumber there.
Yeah, well, thanks. Who was speaking?
Hey, Mark, do you think I'm nuts? I'm doing you a favor as it is, telling you where you can find that purse.
Yeah, I know, but I'd like it. Hello. Hello. You hang up on me. You got that, man?
Oh, most of it. What's the idea of all the stupid questions and that crack about being deaf?
Yeah, just stalling so I can remember his voice if I ever get a chance to hear it again.
Yeah, smart boy, Jim. You ought to be a cop. You got the figure for it anyway.
Oh, that's right.
So they left the purse for me, huh?
Yes.
Oh, I wonder if there's anything in it.
Well, let's take a walk over there and find out.
Timoney follow Friedman's directions and recover the purse under the lumber pile, but it is empty. 2 weeks pass, and Burns daily promises to contact the jewel thieves come to North. Finally, Miss West, advised by friends in New York, contacts Lieutenant F.L. James of the police gangster squad and makes a confidential report of the holdup. James devotes weeks of his time to the case. The sheriff's office and the district attorney's investigators also work on it, but no substantial clue is discovered. Months pass. The May West jewel robbery becomes another unsolved crime. Then, James E. Davis is appointed chief of police. Shortly after taking office, he calls Detective Lieutenant Stone, Robertson, and Kynett into his office for a conference.
Boys, beginning today, you three are to work out of this office as special investigators directly under my supervision. You will be relieved of all routine duties, and I want you to spend all your time on certain cases which haven't been cleared up yet. There are a bunch of robberies that have been hanging fire. For one reason or another, no arrests have been made, and no substantial clues turned up. You know the way I feel about such a state of affairs. I have yet to see the perfect crime. There is no case that can't be solved. It's up to you boys to prove that I'm right. The first case I want you to go to work on is that May West jewel robbery. Go out and get the men that did that job and bring them in here. We'll put them away for a while where they can't bother anyone.
Detective
Detectives Stone and Robertson studied the investigation reports of the officers who had originally worked on the case and then planned their criminological strategy.
Well, it's clear from these reports that only two people knew Miss West was carrying that door around with her.
Yeah, but remember she says here that she thinks maybe somebody started the diamond at the fight.
Ah, that doesn't mean anything. The first thing the stick-up man said was hand me the poke. The only thing in the purse he wanted was the money.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, two people knew about that money. Timoney and Brennan.
Yeah, and Timoney's out. He's been her manager and trusted friend for years.
Right. So that leaves Brennan, who, after all, was only a casual friend. Let's work on that angle.
Holmes, your deduction is astounding.
Elementary, my dear Watson. Elementary.
Okay, all right. Let's get a line on this Brennan guy.
The investigation of Brennan's acquaintances limits itself finally to Edward Friedman as the man most closely resembling the general description of height and weight given in Miss West's report. Friedman, having been booked on a previous charge, the police records include his picture and fingerprints. Stone and Robertson take Miss West, the mug of Friedman, for identification.
Well, is this your man, Miss West?
Oh, let me see now. He's sort of dark and handsome, isn't he?
What about it? Is he the guy?
Well, I can't tell for sure. You see, he had his hat pulled down and his coat collar turned up, so his face is pretty well hidden. But if I could hear his voice or see his hands, why, then I'd be sure.
What do you mean, see his hands?
Oh, he had short, pudgy hands. That was the one thing about him that impressed me.
Well, we'll run this guy down and let you get a look at his hands.
Robertson set out to run down Friedman, but they are blocked when they discover that he's out of town. A couple of weeks pass, and then an anonymous telephone call informs them that he's returned. For several days, they cruise the neighborhood of 6th and Dunsmuir, where Friedman lived, without spotting his car. Then on Thanksgiving Day, accompanied by their wives to avert suspicion, they once more visit the place. This time, they are successful in locating Friedman's coupe parked on 6th Street. For 2 hours, they wait, parked nearby, and then at last a man comes out of an apartment house and approaches the car. They recognize him from the picture in the mug book as Friedman. As he gets into the coupe, Robertson walks up to the right side and Stone closes him on the left side of the car.
Open that door.
What's the big idea?
We're from the detective bureau. Get out.
What's the rap?
We want you for the May West robbery.
It's a bum beat.
Come on, get out of the car.
I'm coming, you big flat foot.
Friedman to the University Police Station, where they question.
You know Dave Brennan?
No.
We know you do.
Well, so what?
We want that jewelry back.
That lousy jewelry. Brennan promised to return it to May West. If he had, I wouldn't be here now.
What did you get for that job?
All I got was a grand.
It's hardly worth it, was it, Friedman?
Well, I needed dough. But it was a crying shame to take that dame's rock.
Well, what are you going to do about it now?
I'll take my rap, and I'll take that double-crossing rat Brennan to the pen with me.
Having obtained Friedman's full confession, Lieutenant Stone calls Miss West and informs her that they have a suspect in custody who has confessed. Miss West asks him to bring the man over to the apartment at once. He and Timoney greet them outside the apartment house.
Miss West, this is Mr. Friedman, the suspect I told you about.
I remember Miss West from the night I held her up.
Oh, yeah. I remember your voice now. This is the man, all right, Lieutenant.
Well, what would you say, Mr. Timoney?
Sounds like him to me, but you have to hear his voice on the phone to be sure.
Well, I guess we could arrange that too, Mr. Timoney.
Now, listen, Lieutenant. I'd like to talk to Mr. Friedman alone. Mind if we get into the car? It's kind of cold standing out here.
Sure, go ahead.
Thanks. Well, here, pal. This office is a big idea.
Listen, Miss West, I'm sorry about the whole thing. I really am. If I'd known you were so regular, I never would have agreed to do it.
Well, it's all very nice to hear, but how about them diamonds of mine, huh?
I don't know where they are. I got a grand for the job, and I was through. Brennan took the rock.
Oh, so Brennan was in on it, eh?
Sure.
Oh, that's the limit. And I call that guy a friend. I guess I'm just a chump.
I made Brennan promise to return the diamonds.
Well, you're good at moving mountains, too.
I wanted to come and tell you about it a lot of times. If I could have gotten the jewels back for you, I would.
Well, you're not a bad guy, Friedman. I don't know, but I feel kind of sorry for you. But that double-crossing Brennan, if I could get my hands on him...
You and me both.
The long arm of the law reaches out for Brennan, and he is arrested in Chicago. Friedman is indicted by the grand jury on December 4th on 2 counts of robbery, the May West job, and a prior holdup. On January 24th, 1934, Friedman goes on trial before Judge Harry Sewell. Day after day, the courtroom is packed as May West gives her testimony. On February 2nd, the jury is given its instructions and retires. At 1 a.m. on February 3rd, the jury files back into the still-crowded courtroom.
Gentlemen of the jury, have you reached a verdict?
We have, Your Honor.
Read the verdict, please.
We, the members of the jury, find the defendant, Edward Friedman, guilty as charged in the indictment of robbery in the second degree.
Stand back there.
Oh, what's this to be the matter, Jim?
Friedman is fainted.
A tough guy, huh? Just a poor hoodlum. He can dish it out, but he can't take it.
Judge Sewell sentenced Friedman to from 2 years to life in San Quentin Penitentiary. He appealed his case, and the appellate court confirmed the judgment. Stubbornly, he carried his fight to the state Supreme Court. But that august body refused to review his case, and Friedman must serve his time. Dave Brennan, instigator of the plot, was arrested in Chicago, jumped a $10,000 bond, and traveled to Miami, Florida, where he was arrested again. Although Captain Stone traveled all the way to Miami to bring back his man, the governor of Florida ruled that as Brennan was under bond in Illinois, he would have to be extradited from that state. So the fight for extradition goes on. We, the police, have performed our duty and discharged our obligation to Miss West and to society in apprehending these criminals. But how quickly they can be locked behind prison bars is a question that can only be answered by those who manipulate the red tape of the law.
Thank you, Chief Davis. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want further information on the May West diamond robbery, you can get the story illustrated in the March issue of the Calling All Cars News. Just drive into any Rio Grande service station and ask for your free copy. You are under no obligation to buy anything. But if you have not yet tried Rio Grande cracked gasoline, we urge you to fill your tank and then hunt for a hill. As soon as Rio Grande cracked reaches your carburetor, you will find your car developing new energy. It will accelerate easier. You will go over hills in seconds where you formerly had to crawl in low gear. You won't have to shift gears so often in traffic. For Rio Grande cracked gasoline with tetraethyl has extra energy, extra speed, extra power, because it's refined by the distinctive cracking process that creates a livelier gasoline. To prove to you that Rio Grande cracked is a better gasoline, we refer you to cities like Oakland, Berkeley, Merced, Los Angeles, and to Maricopa County, Arizona, which have made tests and specify Rio Grande cracked gasoline exclusively for all emergency engines. Wherever it is sold, Rio Grande cracked gasoline powers more police cars, ambulances, fire engines and other emergency equipment than any other brand.
Welcome to the police, calling all cars, attention all cars. Cancellation broadcast 6-9 regarding a holdup. Suspect described in this broadcast is now in custody. That's all. Rolls and quits.
Narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company.